hand you over to Ahmed, who was going to talk about making captions beautiful. What a lovely thing.
Thank you. Still making quiet. This suits me very well because it means that I can hear better. Because when it's a noisy environment, like a bar or a restaurant, work camp, photographer for me personally, and to keep up with the conversation, and I'm guessing the same thing for you too as well, and I do sometimes wish there are captions right in front of me, just so I can follow the conversation and be aware of my surroundings, but that's not possible. The thing is, it's not just about having what is said typed out right in front of me. The quality and the accuracy of those captions matters too, and the context. They all matter. So these are the areas that I want to cover. Making captions right. Making captions work for everyone. Making it beautiful. So it's not about all the caption nonsense. So that also means we also get some SEO benefits as well. So get comfortable in your seat and let me explain. So get comfortable in your seat and get auto captions. It just didn't really work very well in this case. I apologize. So the topic of caption is a very personal one for me. When I hear people talk about captions in my videos, I hear them talk about how it's another thing to do, costs money, I don't have time, I'm going to leave it for the artificial intelligence to do the job. But it's a very personal one for me because I am deaf. And I depend on captions to deeply connect with all videos. So where it needs will not work if there are no captions. Volume gone down. So I always encourage people to use captions for many reasons, but it's not just about talking about my personal benefit, but I want to talk about also the benefit that you get as well. Now I get it, during a live event it's a bit more complicated to organize, and maybe you get someone else to do it live, but when it's a recorded video that you control on your own, it's different. I can't tell you how many times I have wasted my time and energy, money going to the cinema, never understanding anything. But I don't have control over that. But we do have control over our videos. So the one thing that people do use a lot is auto captioning. But there's a thing about auto captioning and bad quality captioning in general. In the deaf community, they are known as corruption. Literally that. So obviously most of us are familiar with auto captioning, and it's good in certain ways, but it's not really something that I enjoy using. And just to clarify, auto caption is not better than nothing. So just because you have it, it doesn't mean that that's it, done, and we're finished. Now, the technology has been great. Just over 10 years ago, Google had announced automatic caption in YouTube, and everyone was like, hooray, we don't have to do it. People say, we're done. And also, it means that more people can access the content. 10 years later, it has gotten better, for example, on a screen, but there are still a long way to go. But I believe that you can never replace the human emotion, the connection. You can't really get robots to do that for you. Humans can do that for you. And I've got some wonderful examples that I would love to show you, or some the good, the bad, and ugly of captions I've seen. So, here's one example. No way can this country ever allow Batman to run this country. Batman. Although I think Batman would be a better choice, I think, in my opinion. NASA did a space launch. Cooperation agent looks good. And I'm thinking, what the hell is a cooperation agent? Cooperationization. Right, got it now. It's just confusing. Obviously, with my name, I don't expect people to get it right. So for other people's name, it's not going to be a sin. Auto caption. At the bottom, you can see it says, for how long. As soon as I saw that, I'm pretty sure that's not a real name. The guy's name is actually Fire Halan. It just happens that you can't really say it like that. And even if it's a, let's just say, a normal name where it's easier to allegedly write, it's not always that easy. Not only is Deborah reading and Teddy Vani, but apparently they want 3% to her pants in Dragon's Den. To this day, I have no idea what this part is. No idea. But all I know is Deborah Maiden is spelled wrong, Teddy Ravani is spelled wrong. That's a wonderful word of auto caption. So I thought, let's go local then. For those who are not from Glasgow, this guy, Kevin Bridges, a local Glaswegian comedian, he said this. And he's thinking, what the hell did he say there? And then it took me a while to realize, oh, he actually said, you're going to book your holiday. That Glaswegian accent. Even better, I saw another clip on YouTube. Again, Kevin Bridges, he came onto the stage, introduction, and he said, literally, he said, thank you, hello. What the auto caption actually picked up is... I should have put a, you know, profanity alert. No, too late now. But it doesn't have to be a Glaswegian Scottish person, even an English person. Apparently the American does not know how to say Huddersfield because it's pronounced Huddersfield. No, I don't get that. That's Huddersfield. My friends, these two guys, they're from Newcastle. They don't swear, but apparently they say that. That's not auto-caption. That is manually put. The person saw it, said that, it actually says something different. And that is actually manual, which means that you have to check, even if it's manual or auto-caption. And I showed it to them, and they were so embarrassed. And then sometimes it's so obvious, you know it's going to be Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Apparently they don't know that. And then there's sometimes some ironic moments where in this news, they're talking about, oh, they were signing to a deaf customer? Oh, right, deaf customer. I get it all the time, I was a caption. And then sometimes it's not so funny, maybe culturally not right, when there's no such thing as this. And because it's actually supposed to be... Whoopsie. So obviously there's something there, it is actually hilarious. I'm laughing at it, even though... I'm angry and laughing at it, but it's funny. But there are times where it's not so funny when it's picking up words that you don't want him to say. Even the beloved Big Bang Theory, I don't know if you can see at the bottom, it says one thing. But actually, he said another. So imagine you have that in your caption. And that's Big Bang Theory. And I believe that is manual, I'm not really sure. Even worse than this is this person is blaming auto-caption on YouTube. At the bottom, he's marked a couple of words in there, so obviously it's offensive. Now, he is blaming YouTube for that. I say, no, it's your fault. You're leaving it on computer to do it for you. You should do it manually yourself. And that is what can happen. And this is just recently, it happened as well. In the SEO world, people say content is king, but in terms of caption, it's about context. The context is really, really important as well. So what I mean by that is that, like I said earlier, it's not just about having what is shared right in front of you said out loud. There are other things you need to be aware of around that as well. This is an example that I absolutely love watching this on Netflix. Greg David, a comedian, he said something that created a subdued laughter. What happened was, he was talking about a joke. He said, I used to depend on my father to be the source of all jokes, but selfishly, he died. Now, obviously, he's supposed to be a joke, but then people are thinking, but it's not a joke, he died. But it's a joke. Subdued laughter. That actually got context of the laughter. It's not just general laughter. It's a bit different. Just like how you speak can add to the scene. Leonard's trying to be macho, masculine, that's good to know. But then after that, he went back to his normal voice as well. I need to know that, and so do many people. They need to know that. Sometimes you are in a room where there's an echo. Simple thing at the bottom can make a big difference to the scene. But then whatever you have at the bottom, make sure, like anything in any language, make sure that you have the correct grammar and punctuation, because a simple comma can make a big difference between let's eat drama against let's eat drama. It's a very, very common thing in the copywriting world. They always love to use this example. Comma. It can shape people's lives. But even a comma can make things different, full stop, all these things, by making it more understandable. So at the bottom, it did not make sense whatsoever because it's auto-caption. But when you add a few things like a comma, a full stop, even a dash, it makes it more readable, separated, it's more understandable. Makes a big difference. But then also, make sure, where appropriate, if you're going to have two words, make sure that the space is in the right place, because between pen and is at the bottom, there's no space. There's no space between pen and is. Ah, dear. Also, like I said, it's not about what is said, it's also about the music. What music is played in the background? I personally love it. Instead of waiting for the credits, you know what music is played during a particular scene. It's great. And sometimes when you're talking about a movie where the local music is not something that you're familiar with, like for example, Black Panther, it's got a bit of an African theme to it, not all the people will be familiar with who is singing what. Because Taylor Swift is not appropriate for Black Panther. But sometimes there are times where, okay, you don't know who is singing what, who's playing what, but sometimes you want to describe the music to set the scene. And I particularly like the way I describe this particular scene in Black Panther. Haunting traditional singing. It was a bit of a fighting battleground going on, everyone was fighting, slow-mo happened, and then there was that music coming on. Maybe I think they should have put a maybe African word in there as well, like African traditional, something like that. But it really set the scene. But sometimes you don't have to go complicated. A simple one as ambient music could make a difference. It's like, right, something's happening, we're entering something. And you can get creative with the way you describe your music. On my own video, someone did this for me. First of all, I didn't know that the song was fairly well. Second of all, it was more of an oompa version, like a trumpet version. I didn't know that, and I thought I was really good. But obviously, it's not just about music, it's about the sound. Where is the sound coming from? Because it could be from many different sources, but in this situation, there's a sound coming from the camcorder that's been played. Not from a TV, not from outside. That makes a difference. And then the sound could again set the scene, because it's building up to a particular moment. Just like this one. The wave and the sound, the music builds up. But then sometimes there are no sounds at all. And that's okay, but sometimes you need to give a bit of a hint. If people are speaking, then you might need to give some indication that there is something going on, but it's inaudible. Or sometimes there's a general hubbub in the background, and there are crowds talking indistinctly while that person is going around his business. But sometimes you can get creative again with the sound, and this one is quite interesting. One of these classic David Attenborough program, Netflix, documentary, we may all know it. And the theme was on the jungle, lots of animal noises from all places. The way they captioned it was overlapping animal vocalization. Quite creative. I thought quite creative. It makes sense to me as well. And I did not know that apparently dolphins, they make a clicking and chittering noise. Did not know that. But because of that, now I know that. I mean, yeah, I could have Googled it, but still. But if you're going to label what animal noises, you know, make sure you label the correct animal, because that's not a penguin. There is a penguin in the scene, I should clarify. The orcas are chasing the penguin. But first of all, I think, penguin not whine. And second of all, orcas are the ones who are really making that noise. So make sure you get the animal noise right as well. So once you have all these in mind, make sure it's easy to read and not just overwhelming, because sometimes there's a temptation to put a lot at the bottom. That's too much. You don't need three lines, you don't need to have it very wide. Short, two lines, simple and clean, that's what you need. But then be aware that if you have open caption, which is burned in the video, you won't be able to see it. So now, unless you're going to pause, you're not going to be able to work out what is said behind there, which is translation of what that person said in French. And that's a problem, because it can happen many, many times. And you can do it at home, but you can't do it in a cinema or anywhere else. But you also have to make sure that whatever I said, the right person is saying the right thing. I was very annoyed about this particular scene. There are three sentences in this scene, but what you don't know is that three sentences are said by three different people, but it's not telling you that at all. So it makes it very hard to work out who is saying what, but apparently it's the same person saying everything, but there are three different people instead. Keep it nice and clean and simple. TED.com do it very well. Clean, simple, clear, easy to read. You can go ambitious, you can go crazy if you want to. One time I did check out the PGA website, and apparently you can customize your caption at the bottom, the style and everything like that. So I checked it out. I went to caption, I checked out the color selection. I thought, let's have some fun with it. So I thought, okay, different text color, different background color. Oh yeah, that looks good. I'm going to go for something, let's go wacky, go wacky. So that's done. What about opaque? Should I make it transparent? Should I make it opaque? I feel like this. Changed everything. The border, the background, the window, the whole lot. Done. Font type. We all love the good old Comic Sans, but nah, let's not go Comic Sans. Let's go cursive. That looks fun, doesn't it? Moving on. Let's go big. We want big captions. And then put some shadow in it, because that's fun as well, isn't it? Right, done. So, I thought I've done a good job. But then I thought, okay, maybe they didn't do a good job, because it ended up looking quite ugly at the bottom. No, it doesn't work. I don't think we need to do that. I don't think we need to have the option of customizing. Keep it clean and simple. So that's what I did. I went back in there, and I cleaned it up. On most occasions, you're going to have this style coming up. But you do not need, in my opinion, to have all these features of cursive and shadow and all these things. I think that's over the top. So, I thought I'd make it to where you saw earlier that TED had. Keep it nice and clean and simple. Simple colors, simple font to use. Not too big, not too wide, all these things. And then in the end, it ended up being better. And I definitely don't need shadow on my caption either. And that looks much more easier to use. You don't need to go crazy. Now, of course, you can get crazy with your way of describing a particular scene. In the scene of Transformers, apparently, there's a language called Old Cybertronian. I didn't know robots speak Old Cybertronian, but apparently one of the robots is in pain, and that's what they said. But this is the thing as well. You don't need to go crazy and go too far ahead of yourself when you're describing people's sound, music, anything like that. Those of us who know the series of Friends, we know Friends, we know there's a character called Janice. She has an interesting laugh. Apparently the laugh is a machine gun fired laughter. Can you do... I'm going to ask not to. Don't do it. Apparently as well, you can laugh in different languages as well. I know a bit of Spanish, but they did not teach me this in class. Interesting. Apparently also, you can boo in a certain way as well. Now, I don't know what posh booing noises means. Boo, and I'm not going to even try it. But apparently you can do that as well. You learn something new. Sometimes, though, it got a bit ridiculous. I have no idea what this means. Intense gay staring. I don't know at what point you need that at the bottom. So, don't is the answer. And then sometimes I love it when they kind of like tease you a bit, like they imply something's going on, so like loudly implied cannibalism. It may be cannibalism, it may be not. Work it out. And then sometimes maybe it's a bit, maybe a bit too far sometimes, and say, merci, I don't know sound. If you don't know that I don't know sound, it's like a, I don't know. That's not necessary. It's easy to write mumbling, I don't know. You don't need to make I don't know sound. Because if you think about it, what about people who don't know English? People from across the world, they're not going to know what the I don't know sound is. And then there's I call it the peace de resistance. The ultimate one. When I found out, I was watching Avengers, and then they put this at the bottom. Can you see? I was literally, that was my screenshot of the TV. I was sitting there, I screamed. And my wife came and said, what happened? I said, look. So, and to clarify, nobody said egg either. So, we've got all these things, but what do you get out of captions? Now, obviously, I'm speaking from a personal experience about deafness, and there are so many people in the UK who are deaf, 1 in 6, it's going to increase, 1 in 5. Think about your own country as well, that could increase. Even in the US, it's over 48 million as well, and that's going to increase. Globally, it's massive. It's a big, big number. So, yes, you could say that you're going to cater for that audience, but what I would say is that you're breaking news. Because the breaking news is that, no, captions are not just for deaf people. Thank you. If you think about it, there are so many people who can benefit from it. People with learning disabilities, people who have some kind of, you know, language difficulty, people who are learning the language, people from different countries, people who just want that better experience by watching it in silence, people want to watch it in different ways. There's so many benefits of captioning, and it's not just for me and deaf people. Many people can benefit, then more people than you think can benefit from it. Which means that you will reach a much larger and engaged audience than you think. Because according to Ofcom, 80% of people who use this caption are neither deaf or hard of hearing. That's Ofcom. And apparently, 85% of people who watch Facebook videos watch it in silence as well. Think about your own behavior. You don't have to be deaf to enjoy caption, but if you're sitting on the bus, sitting somewhere where you need to be quiet, having a sneaky look at work, you might be doing that yourself. Even Facebook realized that captions were very good because they've noticed that the view time has increased when you do video ads, and this prompted them to create a tool to help people to make it easier for them. And then, as we know it, there are going to be more and more videos crossing the internet per minute. By 2020, that is how much. And then by 2023, more than 82% of all consumer traffic will be online videos. It's going to get bigger, then it's wider. So, are you convinced? What does it mean for SEO though? I've mentioned that earlier. But even Google, they've mentioned something about auto-caption in their own guideline. And they've said that you should always, always, always review automatic caption. And that is literally what they said in their own guideline. And I should also point out that Google does not index auto-caption. Only those that are manually uploaded will be indexed. And if they're indexed, then they can read it. Great for SEO. The problem is, if you only depend on auto-caption, the accuracy is debatable. It's about 60 to 80% accuracy. This is a rough number. So to put it into context, if you can put it into context like 1 in 3 words of your blog post is incorrect, is that okay? If 1 in 3 words of your brochure, your website, your book, something you've written, if it's incorrect and you don't think it's good, then why is it okay for captions to have 1 in 3 words incorrect as well? That's up to us to do that. And that's not great for SEO either, if you think about keywords being written the wrong way. Most people use this company called Rev, they do transcription, they do captions. Some of them are automatic, you can do it that way, cheaper, and then you edit it yourself, you can get a human to do it for you. If you don't have the cost to do that, you can upload your video onto YouTube and it will create the automatic caption for you. You can then download it, edit it, upload it again, or you can edit it right there and then, job done, and that's for free. And then there are so many other tools that you can do that as well. And then don't forget, if you're going to have videos and you're going to have captions, you can turn it into a transcript and then you have a blog post. Once you have a transcript on your blog page, put your header in there, done. You've also got a blog post and a video using the caption and the transcript. So I've got some rules that I would recommend that you follow when it comes to captioning. Simple stuff. You need to be clear and true verbatim. What I mean by that, for example, if someone is saying, like, oh, I don't know what, put it all in. You put it all in. Because that is what this person is saying. You're setting the scene. That's how it should be done. Now, sometimes you might want to clean up. You don't have to make it really, really long. But it's still true and clean verbatim. Includes non-speech elements, I've mentioned the music, the sound, or the sound effect, include them as well. As always, like anything you write, make sure you follow the proper grammatical rules. As always, don't eat your grandmother. And use uppercase, lower letters, the noun, the location, the name, simple stuff. We all know that as well. If you have the option, not what people do, but if you have one of these features where you're going to customize your own styling, keep it clean and simple. So don't use Comic Sans, apparently. But that's only possible in certain platforms. If it's going to be on YouTube or something like that, then you're set in one styling, which is fine. You know the big one? Now, I know it's like you don't want to write it, or it's like you're going to write F asterisk asterisk K. No. If the person is saying it out loud, you literally have to write it out loud. It might be, you know, different, might feel awkward, but that is your literal translation of what that person is saying. And it would be great if you can also make sure that you do it before you publish your videos. Two reasons for that. Now, one main one is that so everyone can have access to your video at the same time, rather than sporadically. The second reason is that there are certain YouTube creators, they strongly believe that if you upload your video onto YouTube, and then you decide to edit it because you forgot something, or you want to add something a bit more, if you do it very, very quickly after you publish it, it will affect your initial reach as well. So, it would be ideal if you have everything done, captions done, everything, upload it, and then you leave it, let it settle. Golden rule, never ever depend on auto captions. It is a pain, and it's something that I can't really live with, because it means that I get denied about videos as well. And then when people say stuff like this, oh man, when it's on TV, they said, oh, I'm sorry, we can't bring you that. Like, oh, it's got them. But people also need to see that there is a beauty when it comes to having caption subtitles. Recently, at the Golden Globe, Korean director, he has won an award for his Korean spoken film. It's a foreign film. And he said this. He said, once you overcome the 1-inch tall barrier of subtitles, you will be introduced to so many more amazing films. That was just 3 weeks ago, maybe a month ago. He said that. Not only that is true, but I also want to switch it around by saying, if you do introduce that, you will also have access to so many more amazing people accessing your content as well. More than you think, not just deaf people. So that's why I've got a big challenge for you. I challenge you, first of all, create videos. Videos are awesome. Videos are going to be on the rise. Don't get too worked up about it until you perfect and whatever. One of my friends, Brian Fander, he said, perfection is the enemy of done. Which is a good way of putting it. Create videos. They're awesome. They're beautiful. It's a good way to show your personality, your emotions, everything. But at the same time, I challenge you to caption them. And you never know what that could do to your engagement. Whether someone who doesn't know the language is learning, or someone is sitting on the bus and just watching, but watching, so they're going to skip it. There's so many more people. So I challenge you that, and I'd love to hear what that can happen as well. Thank you.
Okay, depending on which way you want to go with this, you've either got 7 minutes for some sensible questions, or if you want to drag it out, you're just going to be late for lunch. Which I thought was right. So, has anyone got any... So, thank you, Ahmed. That was excellent. From a personal benefit, I have used the YouTube auto-captioning thing because I had to get a transcript for something. And I thought, oh, I don't want to sit and listen to this 17 times. Whacked into YouTube, got the transcript, downloaded it. Yes, there were mistakes in it, but correcting 20 mistakes out of a couple of thousand words was a darn sight easier than having to do the whole thing. So I can recommend that.
But no problem.
There are lots of others. So, questions? Thank you for that. That was great. So, Facebook and YouTube have tools to create captions, but I'm not sure if Instagram and Snapchat and some of these other platforms do. And you see a lot of embedded text that's been put on in iMovie or something like that.
Yeah.
What do you think about that approach, and how easy is it to translate across different platforms?
Instagram and Snapchat, they don't have a specific tool. You have to use a separate tool to create it, and then you upload it onto Instagram and Snapchat. And they are burned on the video, which means that they're called open caption. Open caption is burned. Closed caption, you switch it on and off. And people think that it takes a long time to do it. Yes, there's a little bit of extra thing that you have to do to create it manually on your phone. But you can also do it on the computer as well, because people think that you have to do it all on your phone. So I do think that if you look at how people use it, there are apps. I don't know in iOS, but I know in Android, for example, I believe there's something called AutoCap, something like that. They have that. And it creates what you're saying, but it's auto-caption, and then you manually edit it yourself. And I believe, is it Clip-O-Matic? I think in iOS, I think it's Clip-O-Matic. They have something similar. It creates a transcript, and then you edit it manually, and then you can share it onto Instagram and Snapchat. And there's a reason why you're seeing that, because people are finding it useful and it's important, and it helps with engagement. I don't know about you, but I mute a lot of the videos because it's just noise sometimes. But even sometimes when there is noise, you want to hear the noise, but then someone is saying something in the background, you can't block out. So it is very, very useful, I think. And I do encourage people to try to do that on Instagram, Snapchat, YouTube. Because from desktop, it's easier to do it with the keyboard. Facebook, you have to upload it, and then you edit it there. But if you have done it on YouTube, for example, you've got it perfect, then you can download it and upload it in different places. And that's the benefit of it. You can repurpose your caption into so many different places. And that will save you a lot of headache and time as well.
Yeah, you're going to have to carry on asking questions because lunch hasn't arrived yet. So if we carry on like this, we'll be breaking a Kit Kat into very, very small pieces. So that's as good as it gets. Claire.
I was just wondering about captions, transcripts in different apps. And so I've been taking on the job of editing some transcripts. It's been taken from a podcast, auto caption, or auto transcribe. But I noticed that it had much bigger problems with the foreign accents as opposed to the American accent, and what your experience has been.
I still got, when I get like Red, for example, even though sometimes they give you the option of adding a glossary of your own because they are maybe technical words, I still get those, say, inaudible or unable to hear, whatever it is. So I get that still, and I've had interviews with American people, they get it still. And sometimes I think it's a good thing that they admit it up front that it's inaudible. Because if it's wrong and you're cooking spoon in it and you assume it's okay, then that's annoying. But if they're really struggling and they put it inaudible, then you can check it manually yourself. But that's why it doesn't matter if it's auto caption or it's manually created by a human, you still have to manually check it. It's regardless. Just like the example I've shown you of the Big Bang Theory one and a few others. They're manual, done by a human, but it's still wrong. So just like when you're creating any content that you type in yourself, you write in your book, whatever, just like you do for your own content, you have to check manually as well. That would always exist. I think you've got to be one of the most articulate person in the world to be able to have 100%. But it could be worse. It could be, you know, you could be cutting bridges and then you're screwed.
Talking about WordPress and the sort of word murder, then I thought that can't be.
Yeah, it does happen. The benefit of getting a human to do it for you is that you can add in the glossary, spelling capital W, capital P, put it in correctly. But with auto caption, you just never know what you're going to get, the good and the bad as well. So always check it manually. And that's the other benefit. You mentioned about accent. People struggle with accents, that's a fact around the world. So that is another benefit that everyone can appreciate that. If you don't understand the person because of the accent, there you go, caption. Easy.
Okay, I do have a request as far as lunch is concerned. You may have noticed that we're hoping that most people, once they've picked up their lunch at that end, will bring it down to this end to actually eat it, because otherwise it's going to get peddling in that, up in that corner. But there aren't quite enough chairs, so certainly the back two or three rows, if you can actually, when we're done, pick up your chairs and carry them just through to there, that would make life a hell of a lot easier, because we haven't got enough chairs to have 100 or 90 odd people sitting everywhere at the same time. So if you can do that, that's fine. Has anyone got any other questions for Ahmed? Yes.
Thanks. I was just going to ask you, spoke earlier about Snapchat and obviously Snapchat, for instance. Looking at the moment, TikTok seems to be a similar type of tool that, especially that people are engaging with. Do you know, is there any sort of auto captioning inside there or anything you can use in that platform? Or do you think, is it back to trying to create something, bring it back and edit it locally before you put it back?
I'm pretty sure it's that. You have to do it separately and then you upload it onto TikTok, Snapchat and Instagram. It's all like a similar idea. I'm pretty sure that TikTok don't have an auto captioning feature. One of the reasons, because they're very heavily focused on music. But at the same time, music, you can still capture music, so it doesn't really matter. But you can, you still need to do it on your local computer or on your phone, in a gallery section of your phone, and then you upload it onto TikTok. You don't just go directly to TikTok and then upload it there. But then, this is why the other benefit is that if you record separately, don't always go onto the platform, you've got that video ready and you can publish it in different places as well. That's the benefit of doing it. So, hope that helps.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay, is there anybody else? Just about done. For anyone who's ever been to WordCamp in London, I went a couple of years ago and had a screen like this whacking away in the corner, translating stuff, and this is clever stuff. And I can't remember the name of the company, but they had two or three people tucked away in the corner who were basically typing live this captioning. I was fascinated by this because it was quite the skill was extraordinary, because the speed at which they were hammering the stuff out, but they had a shorthand all their own. And he tried to explain it to me, and it went straight over my head. I didn't understand it at all, but it was very impressive. So if you're in a live conference situation, this is certainly a cheap option because it's free on the net, which is why we haven't let you on the Wi-Fi yet, because otherwise it really would have ground to a standstill. But obviously for big events, they could afford the captioning company, and it was very impressive. But they make mistakes, because if it's live and it's immediate, there's bound to be mistakes. So, as I was saying, in terms of anything you do, proofreading is key, whether it's just something you've written or whether it's something voice and then subsequently means doing. To avoid some of the examples you've come up with, yeah, studious and careful proofreading never goes amiss. And if you're not good at that, just get someone else to have a go through it, because a fresh pair of eyes can make a huge difference. So that's my recommendation. Has anyone else got any questions for me? Because I have been fascinating and I thoroughly enjoyed it.